Thank you. It's a delight and an honor to welcome you to this year's Cryptographers panel. As the conference is celebrating its 20th anniversary, history is very much on everyone's mind. So it's fitting that in our panel this year, we're going to explore and unravel a major episode in the history of modern cryptology. In addition to our regular distinguished set of panelists, we're pleased to have a special guest, Dickie George, Technical Director for Information Assurance at the National Security Agency. Dickie is going to share with us some hitherto unrevealed secrets about the development of the Data Encryption Standard, or DES, as it's commonly called, which was first published in 1976. Now, as many of you know, DES is the cipher that started it all. DES was the first government-developed, widely deployed, and standardized algorithm, encryption algorithm. And in many ways, it gave birth to the modern science of cryptology in the open community. It was the first encryption algorithm that served as a common reference point for scientists to study. Now, before we start our discussion, I think it'd be helpful briefly to set the scene. It's the mid-1970s, and the NSA is working with IBM to develop a new cipher. The NSA takes this cipher and makes some strange and unexplained tweaks to it. The open community wonders if the NSA has built a backdoor into DES. This erupts into a huge controversy, a controversy that eventually reaches the US Senate. But the open community is not yet mature enough to analyze the cipher. It doesn't yet have the tools. Well, our panelists played a major role in the unfolding of this drama in the 1970s. And today, for the very first time, we get to hear their story from both sides. Now, I should mention that our panelists decided not to discuss too many details beforehand because they wanted to retain a sense of freshness and spontaneity. So, in fact, we have no better idea than you exactly what's going to be discussed here. Now, of course, those of you who were here a couple of years ago for this panel may remember, for instance, how Whit Diffie mentioned that the male half of the human race would probably be viewed as obsolete in a few years. Well, I think it became apparent at that point that one of the reasons this panel's so exciting is that we never have any idea exactly what's going to be discussed here. With that, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming our panelists. Whit Diffie, Martin Hellman, Ron Rivest, Ari Juels, and Dickie George. Well, we have so much to discuss today. In addition to DES, we wanted to talk a little bit about the present and future in the world of computer security. But let's begin, perhaps, by having each of you take a couple of minutes to talk about what DES meant for you in the development of your career, or didn't mean for you, and what you think its significance has been for the world of computer security. Whit, would you like to start?
I don't know if you need 2 minutes. In the January 76, incidentally, I think the publication of DES is in 75.
Right, March 75.
March 17th, 75. But the January 76, there was a small meeting at the offices of a man named Paul Barron, who has played a major role in a number of things. He is the real inventor of the internet, if you look at back at, or the ARPANET at least, if you look back at papers in about 1964, and played a huge role in modern modems. And there was a meeting to discuss various things, but DES came to dominate it. And that meeting started a squabble about crypto politics, and I've been making a living off of it ever since.
DES was a gift from the gods to those of us working in academic cryptography. Aside from its commercial implications in terms of actually giving us a system that people could use, it gave us a target. It gave us something to cut our teeth on. And we cut our teeth on it cryptanalytically and learned a lot from it. There's not time to go into the more detailed cryptanalysis, but just in terms of key size, to give an example, and that, of course, was one of the big elements of this debate, DES had a 56-bit key size, which was kind of a strange number to begin with. And at first, it seems to be quite adequate. That's 100,000 million, million keys. And exhaustive search...
Or a billion, billion, for those of us who don't mind a little approximation here.
Okay. it seems like an impossible number to search, and yet Whit and I working together actually looked at that, and at first we thought NBS would increase the key size when we pointed out there was any question of it being searchable, but then we had to refine that. And we looked at highly parallel machines, special purpose hardware, and at really long time constants because of Moore's law. You have to worry that the cost is going to come down. And we then applied those same things in public key cryptography. As early as 1980, I was arguing that if you wanted RSA to be secure into for the lifetime of a person, even 4,000-bit keys, which seemed ridiculous at that time, might not be adequate using those same that same approach.
So may I have back in a moment to the balance of my time, just say one very important influence that I missed is that when I looked at DES, I sort of couldn't believe it could be secure. I couldn't believe they could put out a cipher that they couldn't break. And on the other hand, I sort of couldn't believe they would take the risk of putting out one they could. And that's what led me to the notion of a trapdoor crypto system that emerged to become public key cryptography.
So I often cite New Directions in Cryptography as being the paper that inspired me to work in cryptography. But in fact, there was a lot happening with DES before that paper came out. And I was following your work on analyzing DES. And I think you may remember I sent you a cipher I designed, Marty.
You sent me a few, I think.
Yes. Why is DES so complicated? Why can't you just do it this way? You know, and it looks sort of AES-like with you know, rows and columns and stuff like that, too. So that was very inspirational. As you say, it gave us something to cut our teeth on, to think about why it looked the way it did and what could be done better and what the techniques were. So it was part of the culture at the time. It was interesting to look at and got us going.
I think that for me, the most important contribution of DES when I launched my career as a cryptographer was that I knew nothing about it. I was not contaminated by any of the ideas which were included in the design of DES. I think that I read about DES for the first time after RSA was invented, and as a result, when I was thinking about how to build a public key crypto system, I never thought about the traditional ways. I never thought about using linear feedback shift registers or S-boxes or any of those standard ideas. I was thinking more about my education as a mathematician and computer scientist. So I was thinking about combinatorial optimization problems, number theoretic problems, etc. And it's interesting that the two teams who invented public key cryptography, invented the number theoretic RSA scheme at MIT and GCHQ, both were total amateurs who were not contaminated with any prior knowledge of how things are usually done. And I think there's a lesson there about how to go about inventing something totally new.
For me, I was part of the original evaluation team, and it was fascinating to do both the math and to follow the political arguments that were going on at the time.
Well, now here's your opportunity for the academics. You know, what would you like to ask Dickie George after all of these years, after 35 or so years? What questions remain unanswered in your mind? You look a little like Jerry Springer here or something.
Whit, do you have anything?
Well, what time is your meeting? No.
I've got one then. The key expansion, to explain, DES has a 56-bit key, but it actually needs 768 bits of key because you have 16 iterations or rounds, each needing 48 bits of key. So there's a key expansion algorithm that takes the 56-bit key and expands it into 768 bits. And you can think of that as a kind of error-correcting code because there's now redundancy. And the way DES does it, it just repeats the bits in a seemingly random order. It repeats each bit, I think, 12 to 15 times, something on that order. So the minimum distance, that is, if you change one bit of the 56-bit key, you can change as few as, I think, 12 or 13 bits of the expanded key, whereas a BCH code, which wouldn't have been much harder to implement in the chip, would have had a minimum distance much, much larger. And this means that it would have seemed to make it more secure. Do you have any comment on why that was not done?
Yeah, the first comment is I spent innumerable hours trying to take advantage of that. And that looked to me like the way that I could get in. Mm-hmm. And it was very, very frustrating that I couldn't take advantage of that fact because it sure looked like what we wanted to do. It was not an NSA design.
Right, it was IBM design, right.
And so the ground rules were kind of, if we found a problem, we could fix the problem. I couldn't find a problem with that.
Uh-huh.
And I went back to something that one of the really great designers told me, which was, if you keep it simple, you give something can really analyze. If you try to add a lot of complexity, you may just be masking a real weakness.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a concern that if we did, in fact, try to change that to make it more complicated, we would introduce a flaw that we didn't know about.
Mm-hmm.
So we left it the way it was.
So did you actually foresee what was coming after DES was standardized? Did you see the emergence of academic cryptography and cryptanalysis? Or was it a big surprise for you?
Well, and then this will be me personally.
Yes.
We saw that this was providing something that you talked about earlier. It was, in fact, a problem that the outside world could concentrate on, a real problem, and that's a very necessary thing. What we didn't see was the importance of the internet in providing a virtual critical mass of people who could collaborate on things. And I think that really made a big difference. Mm-hmm. But the fact that it was DES at that time, if it wasn't DES, it would have been something else. It was going to happen. And there were lots of smart people out there working on lots of things. So I think it was great that you had this problem, and the S-boxes gave you an intriguing aspect to spend a lot of time on. So no one could have envisioned how it exploded. And we certainly didn't envision how widespread it was going to be. There's a present both a problem and a product.
That's a question. So when DS was approved, what was your internal vision about its lifetime? It's obviously not going to last forever, particularly with the key size it was given. So was there a target time internally as to when this would have to be replaced?
There was, and don't forget this was a partnership between NBS and NSA. NBS actually believed about 5 years. They said they'd review it in 5 years and see. And there were certainly, when I reviewed the literature, there was a lot of indication that they expected it might change in 5 years. They probably didn't realize how hard the legacy issue would make that. We, at the same time, were used to dealing with the military, where when we said, this is the end of use, that was the end of use. You don't have that freedom in the commercial world. You say, this is the end of use, they say, thank you very much and for your opinion. So we viewed it to last for 10 to 15 years, no longer. And don't forget, you do have to have triple and double DES as a fault.
Yes. Clearly, the issue of the key size was one of the most important decisions that you made, but it is so easy to bypass by using triple DES or by using DES with pre-whitening, post-whitening. So weren't you worried that a good scheme will come out which can have a much larger key than you originally anticipate?
We certainly were aware that could happen, but we weren't worried about it. Once we made the decision to participate in this, it became a ComSec issue. And it really was driven by ComSec. There was an original study that was done, and when Art and I talked about this last year, he said, let's see if we can bring DES out. I spent a lot of time going back through all of the notes, all of the meeting notes, all the reports, to see what happened. One of the very early reports talked about how big it would have to be, and they said 56 bits. And the deputy
director... It's the minimum.
They said it should be 56 bits. And the deputy director said, that's what we will do then, 56 bits. So that was, at that point in time, decided upon. Now, as a minimum, again, when I go back and I talk to the great designers, they say, you know, I asked one of them one time, if you're trying to achieve 56 bits, why don't you make it 112 bits? And he just looked at me like I had really insulted him. And he said, if I'm trying to achieve 56 bits of security, don't you think I can do it with 56-bit variables? Why are you implying I need to build this in? You don't think I'm good?
Actually, you are lucky because I think the outside community would have caught you if you had designed 56 bits of security with 112 bits nominal key size.
That's exactly right. There were a lot of pieces involved in this, and we said that we wanted to provide an algorithm for the public that had exactly the advertised security. We didn't want there to be any shortcut attack on it. And we wanted it to meet the security needs of the world. So when we said it had to be 56 bits, we wanted to be able to go out and honestly say, there is no attack that we know of that's less than 56 bits. And we certainly didn't want to fall prey to something that would later be discovered. We knew we weren't smart enough to know things that people wouldn't find.
So this, however, is slightly different from Proto's recollections of it, which are in a paper of his that was released a few years ago, in which he talked about negotiating with IBM between 48 and 64 and coming out with 56.
Yeah, I heard all those stories. I read all that literature. It is different, but this is what I find in all of the Tordello notes.
The other point is, and this is not a popular approach, but I think it has a lot of virtues, is to have an algorithm. I mean, of course, in public key, we don't know how to do better. In RSA, we run it in thousands of bits to get hundreds of bits of security. Right. But there's no reason not to have an algorithm that takes a crypto variable of a length longer than the advertised, believed security for whatever operational reason. And in particular, of course, in the case of DES, this matter was confused by confusing the key with the key package. And so they added parity into the key, and their documentation, NIST's, is a little ambiguous about what the key is. And in the arguments early on, people tried to play that one way or another.
Right. You asked a whole lot of questions in that question. Again, when I talked to one of the really great designers, and I said, why don't you make it a little bit harder? Why don't you add a few rounds? He said, I want to make my problem the most challenging problem. I want all of the really good attackers to go after my problem because they know that I've cut it as close as I can. So I'm not going to pad it with bits. I'm not going to pad it with rounds. I'm going to give you a challenge and see if you can beat me in a fair fight. So that's why we wouldn't pad. Oh, we also do have other things that we have to deal with in the real world, which is it actually does cost us to make longer variables in every sense.
At that time, I think it did.
It still does. Yeah. Not
in that range it doesn't now, but all right.
Well, it's storage still costs, it's not free. That bit is costing you a small amount of time. So you certainly could do more. But there was no real reason to. It achieved the level of security that we needed. And
an implicit theorem here that I doubt any of us can prove, which is that for a conventional cipher, you can achieve equality between the strength and the length of the key. That's the thing that's exactly not true of any of the public key forms. You can't get closer than a factor of two.
Right.
So with the 35-year hindsight, what would you do differently?
Good work, IBM.
Well, I certainly would have invested in RSA.
One thing that was done differently with AES is that the design and the selection was all public. Whereas that's what one of the things that Whit and I really objected to with DES, that having seen that the key size was questionable, we then worried about possible backdoors being designed in, which is an understandable thing to do. Whereas in AES, there was this public design, public review, much more public selection process.
Yeah, and I think that was very good. I'm not sure that the outside world was ready at the time, and I know that
NSA wasn't ready. No, 75, there wasn't that much, you're right. I mean, there was us and IBM and Ralph Merkel. And then you guys, soon after.
And the political battles inside NSA in 1975 as to what our role was going to be and how much we would play, it was fun to watch.
Talking about public key cryptography today, I've got a question. I've heard, and correct me if it's wrong, that there was a battle basically between, or a dispute between the ComSec and ComInt side of NSA. ComInt wanted low key size so that they could maintain their communications intelligence. ComSec, concerned about American security, wants a higher key size. They eventually settle on 56 bits. Public key cryptography was not available at that point in time. Soon after, it was. And all of a sudden, keys could be changed much more rapidly, which makes even a 56-bit key size much more secure than it was pre-public key cryptography. Was there any consternation when public key came about, like, oh my God, why did we make it 56 bits?
No, there wasn't. Key management is a huge problem for everyone. And I don't think there was any belief that the development of public key cryptography was going to really change the problem that we faced that much. That wasn't an issue. There certainly was a lot of discussion early on, comment versus CompSec, and the decision was made that this was in the best interest of the nation for us to participate. Once we chose to participate, we were playing it in as a completely CompSec role.
There's one thing you mentioned a few minutes ago, which sounds a bit strange to me. You say that your great designers know that if they are building a 56-bit crypto system, it will have 56-bit security. Isn't it a bit overconfidence? I mean, in the academic side, we all invent schemes and they fall apart, and even after years of analysis, surprises can come. So how come, if you're trying to cut it so close, how can your designers be so sure that no one will come up with a better attack?
Well, they're always wrong. I mean, you're right. You're never that good, but that's their goal, is to get to be that good. That they want to achieve that level of security with that number of bits, and that's what they shoot for.
And they felt that they knew exactly all the possible attacks that will be developed?
Well,
don't, of course not.
Well, Ari, Shah shows that they don't.
Right.
I mean, at least in not...
But in the case of Shah, they went public with the modification from Shah 0 to Shah 1. Did you have any contingency plan in case something will be discovered about DES?
Nope.
Doug Hogan said you did. Whatever it was. Doug Hogan said at the time that you did.
Well, let me ask a question. Martin and Witt, I think you were fairly prominent in raising concerns about the possibility of a backdoor.
Or infamous, yeah.
How much conviction did you have that there actually was a backdoor? Was it merely a concern? Was the possibility merely a concern, or did you actually believe that the NSA had intended
it? It was a probabilistic thing, but I thought there was a reasonable probability that there was a backdoor from two points of view. We were being not told the truth about the key size. This wasn't you, Dickie, but other people at NBS who'd come from NSA told me we were absolutely wrong by orders of magnitude in our key size estimates and search times. And so this created some concern on my part that we weren't being told the whole story in other ways as well. And also, when you start to think about it from their point of view, from the comm-int side of the house, 56 bits is horrendously difficult. It's huge. Because before DES, almost everything was unencrypted. They get it for free. And the last time I did the calculation, it was billions of words can be searched for a dollar when they're in clear text form and computer readable. Put even a 40-bit key in there, and suddenly it's very, very expensive. So even the 56-bit keys, while it was inadequate as a single national standard protecting, for example, offshore drilling data worth hundreds of millions of dollars, or medical records that might be viewed without as being priceless in terms of their privacy, it seemed like they would need something much faster than exhaustive search of 56 bits to get it. And then we did find suspicious structure. The summer of 76, I led a team that included WIT, about 10 of us, and we put out a preliminary cryptanalysis of DES. We were able to cut one bit off the key in a chosen text attack, which for a small academic effort over a summer was concerning. But we also found like S4, the fourth S box, was 75% redundant. That is, this row, this bit in this row was the complement of this bit in this row reading that way, things like that. And we found near linearities, which I wish we'd taken it further. We might have had linear cryptanalysis. We tried, never succeeded. But we found lots of suspicious structure that was not explained. That's the other side, never explained, and therefore of concern. Whit?
Well, I believe I was very careful never to say I thought there might be a trapdoor. I mean, it obviously occurred to me, because I'm telling you that's what led me to public key, is what would you do, what could you do about this dilemma? But the primary thing is that I looked at it and saw that the key was large, but it doesn't seem that large, and that...
I never believed that there was a trapdoor, because it made no sense to me politically. The it's very unlikely that the Russian military would use DES for their internal communication. Similarly, the Chinese and all the other targets of the NSA. The main users, intended users, were big American corporations. And it would it sounded stupid to me that the NSA will design a scheme which will be breakable and allow all the large companies, corporations in the US to use it while knowing that they know how to break it, and therefore there is certain probability that others will also be able to break it. So just by political reasoning, it made no sense to me. That
it depends how confident, of course, we don't think there was a trapdoor. I mean, that should be stated. But how confident they were that they could build in a trapdoor that could not be found, and if there was even a theory of trapdoor cryptography. In fact, as Whit was pointing out, public key cryptography really came out of looking for trapdoor ciphers. We were developing a hierarchy within cryptographic problems. The one-way function was the simplest, the conventional system was the next. And we realized, I think even before DES, that there was a need for trapdoor cryptography, because if you are a general, you want really secure cryptography for your soldiers in the field, but you have to worry it's going to be captured by the other side. So trapdoor encryption systems where there's some backdoor that's well hidden would be a general's dream, because now you could use it secure against the enemy. And if the enemy ever starts captures one and uses it, you can break it in an instant.
I'm not sure I'm buying it, because even if Americans had lost such a DES device to the Russians, I don't see the Russians integrating this capture device into their military infrastructure. So,
what about the Vietnamese?
Drug cartel might or something else.
Yeah, the Vietnam War ended in 73, right?
No, it's third world nations. More of a
okay. Well, we could obviously discuss this for hours, and thankfully we'll have an opportunity later on. But let's roll forward to the present day. Dickie, a colleague of yours in the technical, in the Information Assurance Directorate at the NSA, I think Deborah Plunkett was her name, recently made the comment that
this is his boss.
Oh, okay. Well, then you probably know her.
Yes.
She recently made
fine the lady, very fine lady.
Yeah, I'm glad to hear that. She recently made the remark that there's no such thing as secure anymore, meaning that the, as I interpreted it, that the NSA treats its own networks as being in a permanent state of semi-compromise. That's a very powerful statement. So let me ask the panel generally, with regard to cybersecurity, today, what role does cryptography have to play in cybersecurity? And to frame this in terms of the conference theme, what are Alice and Bob up to? And how about Eve? What game are Alice and Bob playing? What is Eve doing? What is Mallory doing? Are we missing somebody in the cast of characters?
Cryptography provides the tools, but I think the problem we're facing still is the rush of technological development. I mean, just the, you know, we're building fences, and the universe is expanding, and so the field that you're trying to cover is growing very quickly, too. I mean, if you just look back at it, I mean, this is, as you said, a time for history. 1961, there was some of the first papers on packet switch networks, you know, Kleinrock's papers there. 1971, the first emails. 1981, the first PC, the first viruses. 1991, the web comes on board. 2001, I guess we got 9/11 comes to mind, I guess, is the thing there. But then now we've got Stuxnet. So I mean, you know, the pace of technology is just enormously fast, and trying to secure all of that means that we're always going to be living in an imperfect world, that we're always going to be chasing after the guys who are doing cattle rustling on the new fields we've got out there for Facebook or whatever.
Cryptography is the best cooked part of this for the simple reason that, in some sense, modern cryptography starts in 1915 to 1920. 1915 is the Dutch claim of developing the first Enigma. 1918 is Hebron here in Oakland, and no question about it. And in some vague sense, you can say that development ending in 2005 with the enunciation of Sweet B. So we have a set of algorithms now that are widely known that we trust for very high-grade traffic, and we expect to last for decades. Okay. Now, that's a 90-year period of work. We've only spent half of that, a bit less than half of it, on secure computing, and so far with certainly nothing like decisive results. And once you leave cryptographic algorithms and get to implementation to all the rest of it, things quickly go downhill.
It's interesting to notice that the two biggest security breaches of last year namely the WikiLeaks and the Stuxnet, had nothing to do with cryptography. And cryptography wouldn't have solved any of those issues. So in the case of the Stuxnet, what I'm struck by is the fact that this targeted the most formidably protected facility. It was probably disconnected from the rest of the internet. Everyone who was working there was probably checked very carefully. I'm sure that all possible security mechanisms were taken, and yet it shows that you can sneak in and modify even the most secure facilities. So now I'm thinking about my poor computer. What kind of chance does my computer have against this kind of attacks? And encrypting the data on my computer wouldn't have solved any of the security problems. So I have a piece of advice to all of you who are going to walk around in the show later, and you'll see hundreds and hundreds of companies. Stop by each one of them and ask, how could you solve, how could you prevent the WikiLeaks incident, and how could you solve the Stuxnet kind of virus?
Well, and the problem, the very unfortunate problem in my mind, is that what does work seems to have nothing to do, is utterly unscalable. If CIPRnet is more secure than NIPRnet and JWix is more secure than CIPRnet, it's all in human security costs of getting clearances and building secured facilities for the terminals and restricting the number of people with access. And that, by its definition, doesn't scale.
On cryptography and cybercrime, cryptography has been the most studied portion of it, probably. But even there, it has to do with implementation. How many laptops, with confidential files were found? How many backup tapes that were not encrypted have been stolen? And people should be doing these things, the simple things, and they're not. It's implementation. And on the other side, even when you implement cryptography, it seems to be implementation. I'm thinking of things like Kotcher and Cryptography Research Inc.'s power analysis attacks on smart cards. The encryption can be really secure, but if you don't pay attention to Tempest considerations, and so in fact, when I heard about that, I thought, gee, why didn't we think about Tempest? We knew about on the outside world about Tempest, and where else are we not looking at things like that? So implementation is really important.
Look, I want to interject a response to Whit's comments earlier, because I object to them. You sort of implied, I think, that cryptography research started in 1950, and it really should have ended now. We're 1915 with Sweet B or something like that. That's the end of it. And I want to just...
I'm not suggesting it should have ended. I'm saying there's no... My statement was, it's twofold. One, I say it was the best cooked part of information security. All right.
Yes.
Cooking it
for
90 years,
yeah.
Right? And I cite Sweet B as the end of of lines of development that I trace back to 1915.
Yeah, yeah.
There are quite a range of very disturbing problems left open. The whole field is paradoxical because you can't prove anything.
Yeah, I just want to emphasize that. Make sure people aren't misinterpreting your remarks.
No.
There really is a rich field of things yet to be done in cryptography. Searching unencrypted data, fully homomorphic encryption is just getting out there, is starting now. Lots of interesting problems, protocol analysis, particularly concurrent protocol analysis and things like that, we don't know how to do yet. So there's a...
Okay, but if you're an InfoSec engineer looking to do something else, if you're not working on cryptography, then very largely you go to a toolkit and to do that part of
it. The toolkit is getting much better, yes.
So actually I have a question to Dickie George. If your boss is saying that the NSA systems are half penetrated, that's at least the assumption. What are you doing about it?
Well, that's a good question. What she said is we have to assume that they have been. And I think if you assume that they haven't been, you're just letting yourself in for a shock. So you really have to change the paradigm, which used to be build high and thick walls and keep the adversary out, to understanding that in today's world, with everything being interconnected, the adversary likely has an access to be inside. So you have to change it from that, keep them out, to try to keep them out, defend yourself better, doing all the smart things, encrypting, patching, doing the simple things, and then know that that's not enough. So continue to constantly look inside to see if bad behavior, to try to find...
So just doing better monitoring, that's the basic idea? Doing better monitoring of what's going on?
It's more than that. It's actually... it's actively going in and looking for behavior that's, that seems to be inappropriate.
And so if you were infiltrated with Stuxnet, would you find it out or not?
I certainly hope we would. And it, of course, when you say us, it's a big us.
That's right.
Because everybody's connected.
I'd like to ask a question, if I may, but since we've got the DES example on the platform of academic NSA interaction, and we've started to see others now with AES and now the SHA-3 competition and so on, too. So what are the principles upon which this sort of evolving relationship, and it's a difficult one, of course, because of the obvious nature of things, but the principles for going forward. I mean, if you guys find a problem with one of the SHA-3 candidates, what happens? Or if we're designing the next phase, some other algorithm down the road, how do we articulate the principles on which this is going to go forward well?
When we find problems with things, we try to get them fixed in the best way we can. And that could be going to a company, it could be going to our users to figure out what we can do to immediately block it.
Yeah.
It is really a problem because there's so much out there to find. But when we find it, we get it fixed, and that's what our job is. We are working extremely hard. One of the things we find is that if you look at us as a target, the same types of tools that are being effective against us are being effective against us in our homes. The world is wide open.
Yeah.
And the commercial world, look at health, you look at the critical infrastructure, you look at industry, we all need the secure solutions, the same secure solutions. We all need the same functionality. If we can partner government, academia, and industry to build those solutions, we make the country better. And that's what we need to do.
You know, I mean, in terms of assuming your networks are penetrated, right? In some sense, the whole one major trend in security is to interactivity, right? I mean, think about if you assume that your networks are penetrated, well, you know where to go looking to see if there's penetration. You instrument your networks better. In the old days, it was a lot more diffuse, and best you could do is run double agents and things like that, try to run agents into opposing organizations that might be reading your traffic and see if you can detect that they're reading your traffic.
So what's your wish list of additional functionalities or primitives that you'd like to see implemented invented? Where are the big holes in our repertoire of weapons?
Part of the problem we have is that our best tool is cryptography, and we don't know how to use it effectively. In fact, some of the ways we use it are not great for security, in the sense that if you have a firewall, yet you have end-to-end encryption, what is the firewall really capable of doing? So how do we marry up the tools, the security tools that we do have, with the other IT tools that can, in fact, help? Signatures are great and they're needed, but they are not going to be sufficient. We need to really have behavioral studies. We need to have tools that will look for that behavior and alarm.
But you're talking about higher level things. I'm talking about primitives. So we probably have strong enough crypto systems. AES 256 seems to be something which will fulfill all our needs for the foreseeable future. We have public key cryptography, we have signature schemes. So what's on your wish list? Is there any functionality that you don't see how to implement in terms of a primitive?
There's none that we don't see how to implement, but getting them implemented and getting them maintained is the problem. So many times, people are the key element, and people will never be perfect. And we talk a lot in my world today about risk management, the perfect being the enemy of the good enough. Well, everyone is making risk management decisions constantly, and the interaction of those risk management decisions puts the larger system at huge risk, an unknown risk. So can you fix people so that they won't make mistakes? Because I think that would solve a lot of the problems.
Well, I'd like to reserve at least a few minutes for closing reflections. What didn't we cover on the panel today that we should have? Either news from the past year or thoughts about the future?
Well, Adi cited the two biggest security, you know, events, problems of the last year, which are Stuxnet and WikiLeaks. On the other side, I think maybe the biggest security accomplishment known to me is the signing of the root of the DNS system. So we now begun the process of installing what's called DNSSEC, DNS security, throughout the domain name system, so that you have much better, once software gets adapted to take advantage of this, you have much better assurance that you're talking to the websites that you think you're talking to. And this should make it much more difficult for various sorts of spam and malware distribution and phishing and all of these things. And we're going to have a panel about, just as we're going to have another panel about this tomorrow, we also have another one about that tomorrow, so stay at the conference.
I'd just like to thank you for having this trip down memory lane, and for you for being kind of like a crystal ball and to seeing some of what was going on that we could only wonder about in 1975, 76, 77 timeframe.
I'd like to give my appreciation too for joining us today. I'd also want to mention on the positive side, to add to Whit's list, the SHA-3 competition is moving forward.
Yep.
We now have five good candidates, and they deserve to be studied carefully and beaten up upon, and hopefully one of them will prove its worth and be chosen and satisfy the needs that we think it needs to satisfy.
I also appreciate your participation and the answers you gave. I think that closer cooperation between the NSA and the academic community could be very helpful. You know, we are in a situation where the sum of the IQs of people on the outside might exceed the sum of the IQs, you know, of people inside. I'm careful not to talk about averages.
So crowdsourcing with all this?
Yes. So in this sense, you know, if there are any things which are not classified but you feel are important for the academic community to address, and, you know, I tried to pull a little bit what kind of primitives or additional functionalities you're interested in. But if you have any good ideas that can be declassified and not 30 years after the fact, like, you know, the discussion of DES, I think the cooperation could be very helpful.
Well, happy to do that. Thanks very much for the opportunity. I really appreciate being here. It's a great group of people to talk to, a lot of fun. I'd like to just put a plug in for continuing crypto research. I think that there are attacks that are yet to be found, and that the challenge, it's there. It's the best game in town. For all of you out there, take the opportunity to make sure that the kids in the neighborhood, at the K-12, know that there is a future in science. And we need those people, because the country needs that brain power. You show them that there is fun to be had, and it's a good life, and there's a job to be done. We need to do it.
Okay, thank you very much.
So let me bring up something along some lines Adi was exploring. I've bugged two or three directors. The previous deputy director for InfoSec, for information assurance, Dickie, several other people. I haven't got any action yet, so let me bring this up publicly. I think that they ought to introduce a policy in document handling that says, and I'm interested in the crypto mathematics, it may apply more broadly, if a paper is 25 years old, it was not classified at birth, it has never been upgraded since, it should be published. Right. And anybody to write a letter to the director, tell him that, I'd be very grateful. I believe, of course, they think they made some mistakes. And I don't want them doing classification reviews of the old stuff. That just weighs the system down. But if something's been sitting around, nobody thought it needed to be classified for 25 years, it ought to be part of their website. It would contribute a great deal to people's understanding of NSA's role in the development of discrete mathematics in the second half of the 20th century. I believe it would be a great resource. People would follow directions there that haven't been followed with the more limited internal resources, and I think that would be a good basis for expanded collaboration, expanded cryptographic research.
And as you know, I still have that letter on my desk.
Yeah, I know that.
Okay, thank you very much. I'd like to mention to the audience that if you're interested in learning more about DES, both Adi and Dickie will be giving invited talks at the cryptography track. Additionally, if you would like a chance to ask your own questions of the panel, we invite you to the Crypto Commons at noon, where we'll have a Q&A session. All right. Please join me in thanking our panelists again.